chances are a cheap, compact super mini will be one of your first steps on the car buying ladder. So naturally, there's a lot of competition when it comes to making a good one. Cars like the Ford Fiesta have stolen the show in recent years, but now big name rivals are closing in. And this, the Renault Clio, is right at the front of the queue.
Fresh from being awarded Best First Car at the 2020 Parkers Awards, the Mark V Clio has undergone major changes that belie the lightly tweaked exterior styling. One of the best-selling cars in Europe, Renault's keen to keep its cash cow feeling fresh and has duly updated the previously clunky-looking interior, among a number of other tweaks.
But will that be enough to fend off the Seat Ibizas, Peugeot 208s, Volkswagen Polos and, of course, the Ford Fiestas of this world? Let's find out.
From launch, the fifth generation Clio comes with a choice of three petrol engines and one diesel. The former is available in 75, 100 and 130 horsepower form, while the latter is an 85 horsepower 1.5 litre. All versions are front-wheel drive, with gearbox options including 5- and 6-speed manuals, as well as a 7-speed automatic and CVT automatic on the turbocharged petrol engines.
Now, believe it or not, this Mark V Clio doesn't carry any parts over from the previous Mark IV version, and while that might not be most apparent from the outside, on the inside, it's really pretty clear because this cabin has been completely overhauled. Now, I should explain that there are four trim levels you can get with this car. There's Play, there's Iconic, there's S Edition, and then there's this, which is the top spec RS line. So it is the most expensive one, but if we're talking about material quality, that has certainly been improved over the Mark IV Clio, because while there are still some cheaper plastics here and there, although do you really care because it is a super mini, for the large part it's been improved because you've got some nice soft touch plastics on all the major touch points and some more besides. The shape of the cabin has been adapted so it's more angled towards the driver, which makes you feel more cocooned in, although you've still got enough space. I'm 5'10" and well, I reckon if I was, you know, 6 foot, over 6 foot, you could still start to feel a little bit cramped, especially compared to a Seat Ibiza or a VW Polo, but for an average sized person, it's perfectly fine. And as I said, you do feel like everything's more angled towards you. And another plus point of that is that the passenger, they have a little bit more knee room and leg room because of that too. Other layout decisions which have been improved is finally the cruise control switches are all on the steering wheel. That sounds like something you'd expect, but in previous Clios, the on-off switch has been located down here, which is always a little bit strange. Now though, it's on the steering wheel, which is a big improvement. And talking of the steering wheel, it's thinner than the Mark IV's steering wheel, so you get a larger view of the dashboard. It's just a nicer thing to hold as well. On this RS line spec car, and you also get it on the S Edition cars as well, you've got a standard 9.3 inch central vertical touchscreen, which is one of the largest ones you can get in this class of car. And it operates a sort of Android style operating system, so you can customize the tiles to where you want them and adapt it for your preferences. And, you know, it's a nice system. The screen is relatively responsive. The intuitiveness, it could be improved, could be just a little bit easier to navigate, but again, it's an improvement over the Mark IV, and compare it to a Fiesta or something like that, and it's pretty much on a par. Lesser versions, you'll get a 7-inch touchscreen instead, which is still a good size, but then on the base play spec model, you get a 4.2 inch screen, which isn't touchscreen, it's just a regular radio display. Another point about this central touchscreen is that Renault has resisted the urge to put all of the functions within it. So you can still have shortcut buttons, which we've got here. We've got these piano style buttons, which are pretty much appearing on every kind of car now. And you've also got these handy climate control dials as well, so you don't have to dive into the system to change any of that, which is a good point. Coming with the 9.3 inch central touchscreen, you've also got a 7-inch digital dashboard display, again on the S Edition and the RS line models, and it's a nice display. You haven't got that much in the way of customization, but it looks good, it's clear, and it's not too distracting. However, it feels like it's been shoehorned in a bit, because you've got a massive area for your fuel level and a massive area for your temperature as well, which alongside it, it doesn't really feel necessary because fuel and temperature, you can have those a lot smaller usually, so it kind of like feels that they're filling space up a little bit where they really don't need to. If you want the best example of this digital dashboard display, you need to pay for the optional 10-inch system, which is a full digital dash, incorporates the fuel and the temperature within it, and that is a much better unit. It's still not quite as good as what you get on a VW Polo for intuitiveness and for the amount of information it displays, but it is an improvement, although, as I said, sadly, it's an optional extra on all models.
If you like your music, you can get the Clio with a Bose audio system that has 8 speakers and an ingenious fresh air subwoofer. Along with a digital dashboard display, it's one of the few optional extras you can get with the Clio because most of the equipment is fitted as standard on the various trim levels. Standard equipment on base play spec models includes aircon, a height adjustable driver's seat, and Bluetooth. If you want the sweet spot when it comes to standard kit though, S Edition cars get features such as the full 9.3-inch touchscreen, a rear view camera, and climate control.
Every time a new car is launched, its exterior dimensions always seem to grow a bit, but this Mark V Clio is actually 12mm shorter than the Mark IV version, but because of some clever packaging, it's actually larger on the inside. So, when I'm sitting in the rear seats, I'll note that I've got about average knee room and leg room, although my feet do feel a little bit squashed under this front seat, but headroom is actually quite a pleasant surprise because it looks quite sleek and slender on the outside, but I've still got, I don't know, about an inch above my head. As I said, I'm 5'10", so this is actually quite a bit better than a number of this car's rivals. If you're going to put people in the back, and that's a big priority though, I would still say that the Ibiza, the Polo, the Fabia, you do get a bit more room. As for people sitting in the middle, they've got a fairly shallow central tunnel, so they don't have to thread their legs either side or something, which is a really awkward shape, so that's a big plus point. And if you're going to put child seats in the back, you've got these nice, easy to access ISOFIX points on the outer rear seats as standard too.
The Clio's boot space is one of its strongest assets, delivering 391 litres with all 5 seats in place. That's 80 litres more than an equivalent Ford Fiesta. However, do note that there is a very high sill leading up to the boot, and if you go for the diesel model, boot space is 25 litres less than the petrol. Before we go on to the driving section, here are 4 things you need to know before buying a Renault Clio. After 3 years and 36,000 miles, a 100 horsepower petrol Clio in iconic spec will be worth around 46% of its original value. When assessed in 2019, the Renault Clio achieved a 5-star safety rating, scoring 96 and 89% for adult and child occupant protection respectively. At the time of filming, Renault is offering a 3-year, 30,000-mile service plan for £499. If the Clio's current engine lineup isn't enough for you, a mild hybrid petrol version is set to join the range in 2020.
The idea that a super mini will only be used on urban roads is pretty outdated because, let's face it, they need to be good at every single kind of driving scenario. So to that end, we'll start with comfort. And as I explained in the interior section, this is a top spec RS line Clio. So it's a sporty version and it's got the sporty large 17-inch alloy wheels. And because of that, the ride is firmer than it would be on any other variant of Clio. However, if you go down to the 16-inch alloy wheels, which is probably going to be the most common size because of the spec levels, then you've got a ride comfort which, although it's not quite as good as the Volkswagen Polo, it is pretty much, I'd say, on a par with the Ford Fiesta. So, you know, it's not going to be as comfortable as a big saloon car, but you can do motorway journeys, you can go around on bumpy town roads, and you won't feel too disturbed in the driving seat or the passenger seat. Happily, all-round refinement in the Clio is very good across the board because even at motorway cruising speeds, there's very little wind noise from the wing mirrors, and especially if you have the smaller alloy wheels fitted, road noise is also nicely hushed as well. The engines vary in how much noise they make, with the petrols, of course, suited to around town driving best, but the diesel does have its place on motorways. And one of the reasons why the diesel is best suited to the motorway is because you can't get a petrol Clio with a 6-speed manual gearbox, and that's a bit of an odd decision considering that every other car in this sector you can get with a petrol and a 6-speed manual. And you might wonder why that makes a difference. Well, having that extra gear means that you can cruise at lower revs on the motorway and use less fuel, and it'll be quieter. Renault's kind of got round that, so it still cruises at a respectable RPM when you're on the motorway at 70 miles an hour. However, to do that, the ratios, when you go from second to third, there's quite a big jump. So you get what feels like a bit of a flat spot of power around the start of third gear, which can make overtaking a little bit tricky. So just bear that in mind when you're considering which engine and gearbox combination you want.
All Clios come as standard with an impressive suite of safety aids, including autonomous emergency braking, lane keeping assist, traffic sign recognition, and cruise control. Meanwhile, the optional traffic and motorway assistance pack, only available with the 130 horsepower petrol automatic, adds adaptive cruise control, stop and go traffic jam assist, and lane centering.
The engine I'm driving now is the 1.3 litre petrol with 130 horsepower and the 7-speed dual clutch automatic transmission, which is the only gearbox you can get with this engine. For 130 horsepower, it really does pull very well indeed, and it's not as if you need to rev it out in every gear, because there's enough torque too, so that you can just press the accelerator about halfway down and it gathers speed really, really nicely. So a good companion on motorways, but very good fun on country roads where you can just get past people without having to really strain the engine too much. That said, around 5,000 RPM, it does start to get a bit boomy, but because of that torque, you don't really need to take it there very often. The 7-speed dual clutch transmission is, on the whole, a good gearbox, but it can be a little bit frustrating in town, because when you go to pull out or do a 3-point turn in a hurry, it's not quite as responsive as you'd want. That is pretty much par for the course with small car automatic gearboxes though, so you can't level that much criticism against it in reality. As for the other engines that you can get in the Clio, well, of course, there's a 75 horsepower non-turbocharged unit, which will be very good for first drivers, but if you plan to take the Clio on longer journeys or you plan to put a lot of people in it, then you will need extra grunt that you can get from the 100 horsepower turbocharged petrol, which is probably the pick of the bunch actually, because it gives a good balance between fuel economy and performance. And of course, you can get it with the 5-speed manual gearbox or a CVT automatic. And finally, the diesel, the 85 horsepower diesel that's available with the 6-speed manual. This will probably be the last Clio where you can get a diesel engine, so enjoy it while it lasts. And if you do a lot of motorway miles or more than average mileage per year, that could be the one to get.
As for handling, the Clio combines relatively quick steering with a stable chassis. It's not quite as enjoyable to drive as a Ford Fiesta, but there's still plenty of fun to be had on a twisty piece of road. It should be a good companion for the city too, with a decent turning circle and good all-round visibility.
If you're looking to buy a Renault Clio but you don't know which one to go for, then here are our top three choices. If you want the cheapest one on offer, then it's the 75 horsepower in play spec. If you're a company car driver, you'll either want one of the diesels for its fuel economy or the 100 horsepower petrol because it has the lowest BIK tax rating. Finally, if you're a performance fan, then there will be an RS model along at some point in the future. But until then, this 130 horsepower petrol has the most performance. And in RS line spec, you get that F1 inspired diffuser at the front, so you can feel just like Daniel Ricciardo on your morning commute.
Renault has spent its money wisely on this fifth generation Clio. Building on the solid platform of the previous model, it left the exterior styling largely untouched and instead gave the cabin a much-needed overhaul, dramatically improved boot space, and added to the levels of tech on offer.
The end result is a well-judged evolution of one of Europe's favourite superminis. And while the Clio is wading back into one of the most competitive segments of the market, you could hardly accuse Renault of going in underprepared.